So I've written a really simple policy really simple policy using SIL, and I'm hitting two issues. And let's just do a quick look over the policy, some of the main properties to keep in mind. So it's called E145. So it's just really simple. Let's look at the as a user file. So you have basically one user session U, which is associated with session role and session type. And we have system U, which is associated with system role and system type. And those are basically the only identifiers in the system, except of course the object role. Now let's have a look at the contexts. So this is the DBus context files, defaults, and the default context here: system role, system T, session R, session T, as you would expect, the system and the session. Default type is a session role and type, and fail-safe context is also a session role and type, and removable context is actually there are plenty other types, but those are object types. So there's only two process types, and this is the PTS and TTI types for the user, for the session. File context subs, this is all not very applicable, it's just some basic stuff. Media, media device types, fixed disk and removable device, and users, this default context for the user. So we have the user context and the target user context, and the system context and the target user context, because all systems processes run with the system context. So that's all very simple. And then basically this is the source. So this is basically everything. Well, there's here the modules, these are the basics, the access vectors. Basically it's only the Linux access vectors, except that we also have the systemd access vectors, and we have them all. So here I have the systemd access vectors that are associated with the system Linux object, and I consider that to be a bug. Should probably have its own systemd object and have those permissions associated with that. But anyways, and then we have basically some other user space objects, access vectors, context for as utils for what is it, as Linux trans, what is it, as transd, and dbus, password, and the service, the system service unit access vector, or the access vector permissions. So basically those are the ones that should only be needed on a bare system, because this is really made for a minimal install. So dbus unfortunately now is actually included with it, with a minimal install, and so is of course systemd. And since those are actually object managers, stuff becomes really different as before, because before a minimal system didn't have any object managers, except I guess password, which wasn't, problems with that weren't encountered much, but they were encountered. We actually had issues where password denied access without login, and I filed a bug for that with PAM, and that was quote fixed unquote. Not sure if that still works, but the same stuff should be done for well, the same stuff is probably done for dbus and for service. But anyways, let's keep this short. There are issues, we'll get to that later. Here's a build shell script, which basically just runs SSLC with the modules. And here we have some class maps. Now that those are pretty basic class maps, so not really applicable for the issues that I'm about to discuss. And here we have some class permission sets. also not really applicable, I suppose, for this issue. Some configuration file, we don't support MLS, and we deny unknown permissions. We should actually try allow unknown. That's a good idea, so I'll leave this open. We might want to try that. Constraints, basic constraints, really the bare minimals. Except I removed the ones related to cron. I'm trying to get rid of cron. So I removed that from the policy. File context is created by SCLC. File patterns, some basic file patterns, nothing special here. IPC patterns, this the tool, the stream connect and the datagram sent ones. ISITs, initial sits, also pretty basic. Here we have the ones that are used, here we have the ones that are not used, and here we have the ordering of the sits. The listing file with all this stuff listed. Miscellaneous patterns. These are some domain transition patterns and stuff like that. MLS seal, so here are the basic MLS declarations. We need, even though we are not using MLS, you all still need these for some reason. And then we have here the object. So this is pretty basic. We declare an object to a role, and then we have some macros that basically associate the object role with either a process type or a object type, I suppose. And we have two policy capabilities, the peer and the open perms. Okay, so now to the modules. So modules are really simple. It's just basically declare some types, associate some security contexts with objects. So you have type declaration, make a type usable here with the macro call, and then the context for the type above. Same here, shell, it's a bin object, and these are all the shells, shell objects. And then we have macros, but what we have here is we have a file object macro, which basically associates the object role with all types that are associated with its bin file object. So if I create a new bin file object, so I'll create a new type and then associate core commands bin object to it, then that type is automatically associated with the object R role. So that's my way of using these. I'm not basically calling these macros for each type that I declare, but instead I'm just associating and using type attributes. And that's basically one thing that I suspect might be somehow related to issues that I'm seeing. This is the devices, so basically it's the same idea, except that there are some type attributes and some, maybe some never allow rules there. But here you have that same object role type. Oh, actually, yeah, this, what this does is it basically associates the is bin file object with the files object, and the files object associates it with the role. So yeah, it's a bit nested, so to speak. But eventually everything is associated with the object R role, else it won't build, I think. But hey, so same idea, you declare a type, you make the type usable, and then you specify the context. That's for each entry here. That's basically all it is. So a whole list of declarations and file context context specifications. And then you have here some type attributes, which should just work. And here some basic rules, nothing special. But here you have basically unconfined access. So basically what the idea is here, that you have basically two contexts, two process contexts, and both are unconfined. That's basically what I want. This really simple policy, two process contexts, both are unconfined. So all I'm doing is basically setting up the base modules to the base types, so to speak, and then provide unconfined access to that using the unconfined rules here, and then basically making both contexts unconfined. So that's basically, I'm only using creating the macros needed to either provide unconfined access or the ones that require or are related to never allow rules, because I also have never allow rules implemented here in this policy. And that's basically it. This only unconfined access to the module. There's no rules, not many rules there. Nothing is really confined. Same here. This is the files module. So a whole bunch of declarations, new attributes to make the types usable or actually classify the types. And then it's basically declarations, make them usable, and then context, and that's all the way down. And then there's just basically unconfined access. But again here, call files object. So all these types here declared here, or most of them, these ones, are associated with files objects. Files object, and files object is associated with object R. So that's how the object role is associated with all these types indirectly via the files object macro, which can be found here. So we have basically is file object is associated with the type that calls it, and then there's an is file object here, a rule here that basically associates it with the role. Where is that? Must be here somewhere. Probably here it is. So here basically all types associated with this file object are calling the object role type, so that's how the role is object R role is associated. And this is unconfined access to file types, and then some basic macros which basically classify the various different types, file types, and unconfined access. And so on and so on. So basically now you get the drill about how I'm trying to get around the nastiness of the object R that needs to be associated to all the types. I'm trying to basically do that automatically by using type attributes. And the main idea about all these, how these modules are very simple, all they do is declare types and declare context specifications and then provide unconfined access to the types that are declared in the module. Same here, and it looks much, but that's just all the context specifications and the types declared, and then the unconfined access, and then some basic macros that provide, for example, unconfined access to the network in this case, and stuff like that. And so let's peruse them real quick here. As Linux, same idea, just types and contacts. Session, so here you have a user, the user stuff, it's all declared in a single module. You declare a user identity, a role, and then here, this is where I'm actually explicitly associating the identity to the object user role here, so that the type role, associated role type, system R, access to session R, then some devices. So here, this is also related to a problem. So basically, here I'm creating two terminal device nodes, and then associating them with terminal user PTI and terminal user TTI objects. And here we have the entry bin entry rules that allow login programs to actually manually transition to the user context on shell and bin files. And actually I should probably remove bin because this is used on shell only, I suppose. Anyways, and then the subject user exemption target, so this is a net type attribute, so that to tell us Linux, okay, this is a user. And then we have some, here we call the unconfined, so this user is unconfined, the session T type. And then we have some rules for allowing login programs to transition to the proper session type. And so that's that. So let's look at subject. Subject is basically the domains module, so the rules related to all processes. It's the same. There's a boolean. There are some booleans in this policy for some mem protect stuff and mmap low and exec mem and stuff like that. Nothing too serious. And oh yeah, and secure mode, insmod, and stuff like that. So some type attributes here. Basically, that's all it is. Type attributes and never allow rules and unconfined access to all process types subjects. And then some macros here that allow unconfined access and stuff like that. And then the system one, it's same, it's all the same, it's all very limited. There's no actual explicit rules, it's all unconfined access. Really simple. If you look at it from the sense of just declaring some identifiers and then labeling objects and then providing unconfined access to it. Except here that I actually made dev PTS. There's some others here, some sections other, and those are all sections that you should see as some customization that later should be removed or just workarounds. So here basically I'm making dev PTS a terminal login PTI. I'm not sure if this is actually needed, but it might be needed for SELINT compute a relabel to relabel to the user dev PTS, which is currently not working. So I'm basically saying, okay, make dev PTS type a terminal login PTI type for now, just to figure it out. And then there's this unconfined module, which basically provides unconfined access to all this whole policy. And basically very simple as well. Some tunables here, and here we have unconfined access to the user space object managers. And in theory, this should be, basically should just work. And it does work for the most part, except there's two issues here. One issue is that LoginD fails in enforcing mode, but it doesn't log anything. So I can't figure out why LoginD fails in enforcing mode, but not in permissive mode. So since I only have two process security contexts, I decided, okay, let's make both process types permissive, and then it should work, because that's basically theoretically the same as the whole system permissive, because there are only two process types. Now that's not the case. So although the only two processes on the system are permissive each, it still fails. Whereas if I would run the system in permissive, it would work. So that's some weird stuff there. But the main issue is there's no AVC denials. There should be AVC denials. If I if something is, as Linux is blocking something, there should be AVC denials. If that basic requirement is not met, then it becomes unusable because it's hard to troubleshoot. So that's one issue. And the other issue is that the login terminals, the PTI and TTI, aren't labeled by the login programs. Although I do have the rules in place, I do have the type change rules, which are prerequisite for the SELINT compute relabel. So here I have if you look in the lower left, you see three type change rules for session T on device TTI, type change to device session TTI, and on dev PTS, type change to device session PTS, and on console device, type change to device session TTI as well, when if console login is set to enabled, and it is set to enabled. So in theory, if I log in, I should actually get these terminal types, because these login programs should call SELINT compute relabel and relabel. But the problem is that it's not happening. So for example, here I'm logging in with SSH and I'm looking at dev PTS, where the default type is dev PTS for console or for terminals, but it doesn't relabel it. Although there is a rule that says SessionT, DevPTS, relabel to set device SessionPTST. And I also made DevPTST a login PTI. So, not that that matters much, but in theory, that should allow this to happen. And to show you that I am actually in the proper context, ID is, so the ID is computed properly, I suppose. I could actually nano, let's see, SSHD, and then let's have a look at man, Linux. Let's see if it has any problems with computing it. Do we? Oh yeah, we have a debug and verbose. So I could actually add debug verbose. To see if it actually has any problems with that stuff. Ouch. You work for both. Do I have any typos? No, I don't. So why isn't that working? Damn, this sucks. Oh, it just took a little time. So the SSH is also set in debug mode because. So let's have a look. So basically, it says here security context. Session U, session R, session T is assigned. Key creation context is assigned. So that's all properly. And then SSH setup variable, setting execution context, that's all fine. But if I look at lsalz devpts, then you see it's not labeled properly. The identity is set properly because it's created by me, I suppose. But the type is not changed. And there is a type change rule there. So why isn't that working? Let's see, search, sudo shell abc123 and then search asct as session d. I already showed you that, so that shouldn't be. They are there, the type change rules. So why is the type not changing from DevPTS to device session PTSD? That's the question. All right, so get and force. We're in permissive mode. Nano etc as in Linux config. Let's actually first just show you how it is in permissive mode. So let's just shut down. Shut down reverb now. To show you that it works in permissive mode. Basically, now the policy that's actually loaded might differ a teeny weeny bit from the policy that I've been showing you because I've been trying to fix this shit. To be honest, but or at least to troubleshoot it, and that's why I sometimes added some rules here and there. But all none of them makes sense if you think about it. It's just two unconfined domains and some type change rules, and it should just work. But it doesn't. So let's just log in. Okay, sudo shell. And if you look at this out, then you see that the sdpm, the systemdpm, is loaded, and the systemd -s user is loaded, so that works. Now in enforcing mode, that systemdpm and systemd user is not start, is can't start. It can't start system or user slice. Anyway, so journal control B, and all the way down. So this is debug, this is not it, but here you have where it starts user slice. Here, starting users 1000 slice. This is where it fails in enforcing mode. That's here some pump systemd debug that I added because trying to figure out what this is. Now here you have some stuff here with the security contacts, as setup variables, blah blah blah. It doesn't say anything about changing the TTI. Here it says, setup TTI, PTI. Setting TTI context on dev PTS 0. Well, so it thinks it sets it properly, but it doesn't. So I think that is a SSCLC bug, where those rules are in the policy but aren't in the policy. The same issue as what we had with the Booleans. The ordering issue, probably, something like that. They aren't recognized by the legacy Linux functions for some reason, but they are in the policy as shown with SESearch. So this basically works in permissive mode fine, except that the terminals aren't labeled. That's another issue. So let's just nano etc selinux config. Oh, and by the way, there aren't any AFC denials. I can already tell you that, but I'll just assert and user AFC AFC Linux TS recent none. So just to make that quite clear, shut down, reboot now. So now we're in loading it in enforcing mode, and then I'll show you the difference with login D and that there are no AFC denials. And I've been told that that's something to do with dbus, or yeah, but it's weird because I do have the dbus access vectors loaded, so it should log something. I do have all the systemd object classes, sudo shell abc123, and then the out search again to show you that it's clean on abc denials first. Find it. Christ sakes, might as well just type it in. And it's clean. No AFC denials. D message grab denied. D message grab as Linux. You see that there's only one minor issue where this thing is hard-coded. I labeled it run T, but somehow in mount basically the mount points, the different mount points, basically for some reason it has the context hard-coded somewhere. We can't figure out where that is, but basically all the mount points depend on the type, but you can just override that and nothing really happens. It's just invalid, and it, later on it labels it properly, no problems there. because if I do LSLC run or grab run, you'll see that it's run T instead of var run T. So I just use a different type and then it bars. Anyway, so let's look at journal control. B. Oh, not N. B. And have a look there. Now this is all white, fine. But here you get some red stuff. So where it actually... Oh yeah, so here it actually starts to use a slice and then fails. Because here is access denied. Fail to start user slice, access denied. And here again, fail to start user slice, access denied. No AVC denials, no, nowhere. And in permission mode it works. In enforcement mode it doesn't work, even though the two types involved are permissive types. So that's another weird thing. If all the types on the system are permissive, then shouldn't that equal permissive mode? I would gather that that should, but for some reason that isn't. And that might be actually related to a user space object manager stuff. Anyway, so and if I do a PS out, then you see that, that there's no SD PAM because it wasn't able to start that stuff. So yeah, that's the other issue. Now let's just try CD etc ASI Linux E145 source, and let's just nano config sale, and let's just say handle unknown allowed, just for shits and giggles, and then build it. And then let's just basically shut down reboot now. And that should build with unknown access vectors allowed. And let's just see if that makes any difference, if that makes it worse, yes or no. Probably not, because it doesn't apply to a user space object objects, I suppose. But we'll see. But on this configuration, this small, simple configuration, these are already two issues that I'm hitting. Let's just journal control again. And see, the same issue is still there. It's still failing permission denied. And even though ASI status will say that, oh, denied unknown status is still denied. Oh, shit. CD etc ASI Linux, I forgot a step. E145 source, and I don't need to rebuild, I just need to copy over the new policy. I forgot to copy over the policy file. Hopefully I can find it. Yeah, here. So then basically, yeah. Sorry about that. I built it, but I didn't copy it to the right place. Let's see if it works now. But probably not. My experience tells me that it might not work. Come on. Allowed. Now it's allowed the unknown stuff. And now actually it does work. Seemingly. Yeah. It actually does work. So we're dealing, so this makes actually makes sense. We're dealing with an object, an unknown object, but I don't know which one it is, because Life as Linux doesn't tell me which one it is. And I know it's not a Linux object, because if it was a Linux object, then SELinux would have taught me. That's the nice thing about SELinux, the Linux object manager, is that it tells you if you have an unknown access vector. It tells you, okay, this is the unknown access vector, and policy says that I will deny or allow it if I encounter it. But with these user space objects, I'm not getting any message. I don't know which object is missing, and I do have XC system. I have all the system ones, the known ones, status, reboot, disable, enable, undefined, halt, reload, and I have service. You would have expected it to be either systemd related or dbus related, because those are the only basic components in a minimal install that actually have SELinux awareness. So here we have service stop, status, disable, enable, kill, load, reload, and start. And kill and load shouldn't actually be needed. You can actually probably remove those, because those are no longer active. So I need to figure out which ones I'm missing. And as is for dbus, they're also there. Dbus. XC dbus. So you tell me which access vectors am I missing. It must be user space, and I also have password, which might or may not be needed, and I have context. Now you tell me which user space access vectors do I not have. Tell me that. I need to figure that out. And that's basically, so this issue is basically a known issue, the second issue. The first issue with the types don't change for the terminals, that's an issue that I can't explain. Let's have a look if that's still the case. And it's still the case. So that's something I can't explain really. But the rules are there. Well, I don't know how to. Anyways, that's all. I hope you understand the issue. Oh, not this.